And this one goes out to Eric White and Jeremiah Banks. We're going to talk about principle today. We're going to talk about covenants. We're going to talk about how anciently a man's word was his most valuable asset. And you couldn't break that word, or it meant your life. Now, Eric White, you broke your word. Jeremiah Banks, you broke your word. And to me, I was raised up on those ancient principles of a man's word being his bond and his bond being his life. And he should give his life before his word shall fail. I hold these truths sacred. Obviously, you don't, because there's a lot of adults out there that never grew up. So we therefore have grown teenagers, or grown infants in some cases. They never became men. Some may say that what they refer to as the Middle East is a very troubled place. But there was a time when things were even worse. When there was armies and bands of thieves. There were regular famines on the earth. I'm taking you back to ancient biblical times, which both of you men claim to believe in, but you don't. It's a hypocrisy to not keep your word. Devarim 23 and 24 says it here. There were regular famines and droughts, and these help explain the warfares and the highway robbery that took place in these times, right? It was a hard scramble. It was a world without convenience. They didn't have stoves. They didn't have refrigerators, right? You made your own food. You planted your own gardens. You hunted. And it was right outside of your window. And if you wanted to keep it, you had to defend it. So the fear that these people experienced was unimaginable. It was impossible to even appreciate in this day and age when you got men like Jeremiah Banks and Eric White. Now, how did these men reassure each other in a way that was strong enough and binding enough? They needed some exceptional strong bonds. What's the paradox here? So paradoxically, they got them by what is known as cutting covenants. You guys hear the word covenant a lot, but do you really know the meaning of it? When you go with the etymology of the word covenant, you say, oh, covenant, tazadaq, that means contract. See, when a covenant was made in ancient times, I'm talking about under ancient Israelites, which neither you know nothing about, you claim to, because of your hypocrisy. You have no honor. When a covenant was made, it was said to cut, covenant, cut, covenant, cut. The Ibrit, karat, barif, means to cut a covenant to a god. Karat, barif, to cut a covenant to a god. What? Now, you may have actually heard that a covenant is a contract in modern times. Study a law book, and you think you're in the know, but you're really not. See, I told you about the word of the Most High. This modern day, so yeah. Well, it is in a way. But by comparison, the modern contract is a bloodless thing. Men will always call to witness the cut from which came covenant. I'm talking to someone right now, let me enlighten you. So you listen, you just may learn something and be enlightened and stop being a hypocrite. So when they were cut, one, or maybe even more animals, usually as many of them as were needed to feed the crowd. Well, you say, oh, Tazadaq, that's barbaric. But wait a minute. It gets better. The animals would actually be cut in two. It would be cut in two. Then the halves were actually literally laid on the ground side by side, joined only by the lines of blood in the sand. Then the parties to the covenant made their promises, like you made, Jeremiah Banks and bro, like you made, Eric White and bro. And so one might say, these promises was made before Yahweh, the Most High. And these witnesses will be bound to you. And when you call, I will come. That's the point of these covenants. See, your enemies will be my enemies. And so on and so forth. That was the whole point of these covenants. Then the other man will say something similar. Then they will walk the bloody way. Getting blood on the hem of their garments, on their feet, and on the crook of their garments, on their robes. So as they did so, the witnesses would shout their approval. Then a feast would take place. A feast would break out. What was this feast about, Tazadaq? Why couldn't they just shake hands like they done with the Edomites' time? They sealed things on a handshake like so-called civilized people. Well, that's not a culture. You said, Tazadaq, they could just shake hands and it would be done. The reason is these agreements had to have some bite. Right? They were sealed by blood. Now here's why. Watch this. When the rumor has it that 10,000 Midianites are coming your way because of a plague that hit their land, let's say a plague of locusts wiped out their crops, and your neighbors between them and you calls for help, what could possibly keep you from turning the other way and running for your life? A handshake? Maybe. But if you was exceptionally a principled man, no. What you need to still your nerves at that moment is that threat of blood vengeance that you made with your brother. And that's what the covenant promised. See, the world is a covenant. When the men walked the bloody way, they declared, in effect, if I fail to keep my promise, do to me what we have done to this animal. Of these animals. This is where Maces and everyone got it from. They got it from us. The Hebrews. See, keeping a promise, Jeremiah Banks, keeping a promise, Eric White, was life. Breaking the promise was death. You understand what I'm saying to you? You men don't have no honor. See, in this world right here that we live in today, it seems way over the top, huh? But if you spend a few nights in the desert without your cell phone, the world could look very different. See, we tend to look back at these people and refer to them as Bidians. We look at them with contempt. Isn't that right, Jeremiah Banks? Young man, huh? Young and ignorant, the older man's wisdom is better than a young man's knowledge, Jeremiah Banks. You gotta learn that the hard way. See, the world that we live in is too small for open-minded people like you and I. But we flatter ourselves, Eric White. We live in a damn bubble. An immersed bubble that we have confused with the real world. You're in a bubble, homie. Covenants literally sheltered those people. Yeah, they live in smaller shelters than we do today. But at least they can still step outside and will fill the real world with all its fearsome power and immensely threats. Now, ironically, the men of those days were actually larger than we are in many ways, because they had to be to survive. Never think of them as things to love or as ways to love someone. Compliance is all that anyone can and should expect. It is compliance. See, the making of laws has actually been compared to the making of sausage. You got scrapes. You have desperate interests. They're pressed together in an unappetizing process called litigations. But in a covenant ceremony, we see a different way to make law. Covenant promises legally bind covenants. The bloody mess is somewhat like the bloody mess that is accomplished at both. And like both, it calls for a celebration, a big party, because the law and the covenant serve the people that are bound by them. You men don't get that. They make the covenant stronger and more secure. And they are human faces. They're at the covenant, smiling at each other over a roast and sacrifice. The covenant of marriage. See, marriage is a covenant. Marriage is a kind of covenant. In fact, you've heard the word covenant applied to marriage. In a marriage covenant, a husband and a wife promises to give each other shelter. What are you talking about, Tazadaq? You can hear it clearly in the traditional vows. For better or for worse, till death do us apart. Sometimes the bond is painful to bear, but historically people realize that for a great deal, they're considered its demands reasonable. And the covenant binds the man and the woman so completely that it changes them. And they receive new names. See, traditionally, you know, there's no such thing as Jada Pinkett Smith, where a woman retains her name. See, traditionally in real covenant, the woman was given the husband's name, which means the house was bound. See, you understand what I'm saying? The woman was given a new title. She was given the man's last name. The man was given a new name. The man's new name was a husband. Husband. Why was he called a husband? Which means to house bond. House bond. Understand? House for house. And bond for bond. Because he will bond the house together. So we see how one thing leads to another. Marriage makes a shelter. It establishes a household. We've arrived. This is the foundation of a household. A household is established through binding promises made in the presence of witnesses. It isn't the result of two people moving in with each other. It's not just that. It's deeper than that. It isn't even a covenant written in ink. It is a matter of life and death. Covenant should be added here. It was common sense once, but isn't so common anymore. Today, see, in the ancient world, covenants was usually imposed from above, from the Most High. They bound sovereigns and subjects. A king, for example, was made up of many households. A kingdom was made up of many households bound by a ruling house. You could say a kingdom was a household of houses. See, the reason that this is important, Jeremiah Banks and Eric White, is to keep in mind that the work of sheltering each other is not evenly distributed. The responsibility falls primarily on the sovereign. Subjects are supposed to support and defend the king, of course, but primarily, it is his responsibility to defend it. The same thing goes for the household naturally. The husband shelters the wife and their dependents, and they in turn support him. Do you understand? Your word is your bond, and your word comes with a covenant. But in this day and age, it seems as though a man's word doesn't mean a thing. Isn't that right, Eric White? Jeremiah Banks. You're going to be judged for every word that comes out of your mouth. You make a covenant. When we read Devorian 23, right? Most High tells us when we make a vow, keep that vow. You go to every extreme to keep that vow. But I hate a man when his word means nothing. When his word doesn't mean a thing. You give your word and you break it. Covenant means nothing to you. You never understood what being a man is. Even lesser, a man of the Most High. So your word don't mean a friggin' thing, and you break it with ease. Your word don't mean a thing. Deuteronomy 23rd chapter. Verse 25. Deuteronomy 23:25 says, and when thou Slack it. Book of Deuteronomy 23:21. It says, when thou shalt make a vow unto Adonai, Yahuwah, thou shalt not slack to pay it for Adonai, thy Yahuwah will surely require it of thee, and it will be sin in thee. So you're going to be judged for everything that comes out of your mouth. Learn to keep your word. I detest a man when his word means nothing.